I think everyone understands this. The plan will be, Chris will give a couple of minutes talk about her bid for selectmen, and then Greg will give a little talk about his, like 1 or 2 minutes each, just to sort of set the stage. Then I'll open the floor for questions, and then we'll have each of them answer as is appropriate.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. I did write things down because I felt as though there was a lot of things I wanted to cover in the first 2 to 3 minutes.
1 to 2 minutes.
Hopefully. I'm Chris Keefe, for those of you who don't know me. I'm currently on your Board of Selectmen. I've lived in Berlin since 1984, when my husband took a job at Digital in Hudson. We've raised our family of 4 children here, and my 6-year-old twin grandchildren are now living in Berlin and attending Berlin Memorial School. One of my passions is for children and their education, so it seemed natural for me, when I first got involved, that it be with the schools. I was a classroom volunteer, a member of the original Link parent-teacher organization, on the Tohonto School Council, and went on to serve on the Berlin and Regional School Committees for 15 years while my kids grew up. Soon after my tenure on the school committee ended, I was recruited and appointed to the Berlin Finance Committee for 3 years. And all of the knowledge that I acquired on the school committee and the finance committee prepared me so that when the opportunity arose 3 years ago, I decided to run for selectman. As your selectman, I've been involved in many issues, but want to share just a few. The property on South Street, adjacent to the school called the Capes of Berlin. I continue to have dialogue with the property owner, Mark Rhodes, to see if there's opportunities for the town to acquire the property, which I know is near and dear to a lot of people's hearts. SA Farms, several residents brought to our attention the impact that SA Farms, located in Northborough, was having on the residents here in Berlin. I've stayed in close contact with their town administrator on this issue, and most recently, the Board of Selectmen voted to sign on to composting legislation supporting the town of Northborough. I'm actively involved in the discussions with the Department of Environmental Protection regarding Maplewood Farms to ensure that their earth importation is clean and not a hazard to the residents living in Berlin. We have started having meetings called coffee talks with the selectmen, which we plan on continuing after the election. And it is a tremendous way to hear how we're doing and hear the concerns of residents in Berlin. This gives us the opportunity for input from the community and to hear what is most important to you. We've heard concerns about traffic, trash, properties that are in need of remediation, and a request to get the annual town report and the annual town meeting warrant earlier, which is now, by the way, up on the town website. We're working diligently with Representative Naughton on getting a traffic study, and I have reached out to the owner of several commercial properties to find a solution to the trash concerns. Town officials and I are in the process of researching the process and cost of remediation of the Tolman property. Fiscal responsibilities. No one wants to see their taxes increase. I've pushed back on budgets that are exceedingly high, and I fight for items that should be addressed. Most recently, I lobbied for several of our town employees who were in need of added hours because of their increased responsibilities, and was able to do this without an added increase in your taxes. As Berlin grows in the next several years, I hope to help control the growth to lessen the impact on residents with the addition of a hotel, over 55 developments, businesses coming to fill those vacant spaces at Solomon Pond Mall and Highland Commons, or independent shops like Red Barn Coffee. Each expansion has a fiscal impact. My experience in town government has prepared me well to understand this ongoing responsibility, how to deal with the budget implications, and how to control the growth in our budget as well. Transparency and communication. In order to have better communication, we the select board have eliminated liaisons. At our selectmen's meetings, we're now having reports and follow-ups with boards, committees, and department heads. This increases transparency for the public too. We have just finished a review of the executives, or I have just finished a review of the executive session minutes of several years, which prior to my term, no chairman has done in a very long time. There have been times when information comes to the board, which must remain confidential due to personnel issues or being executive session material, and my hope is that the public has enough trust in me to know that I will always do my best to make the right decisions on the town and employees' behalf. I have the municipal experience to continue to work as a member of the Board of Selectmen, and I have the time for this endeavor. As we move towards a town administrator, the Board of Selectmen will be an integral part in working closely with that person to help shape policies and make decisions. My municipal experience on school committee, finance committee, and of course being on the Board of Selectmen, along with my historical knowledge of Berlin and its people, will certainly help the town administrator understand what members of the community want for the town of Berlin. And the past 3 years have gone very fast. I continue to learn something new every day. Another passion of mine is serving the wonderful people here in the town of Berlin. Being a selectman involves problem solving, research, good communication skills, and being a good listener to all people. And in the end, making a fair and reasonable decision with my fellow board members. That makes the best sense for the town.
Good evening. Thank you all for coming. I'm just going to speak freely here. I'm going to try and keep it to the 3 to 5. My wife and I met in Marlboro. We went to high school together right next door, and we moved to Berlin because we love the school system, we love the space, we love the town. It's a great environment to raise kids, and we've met so many wonderful people here. So I'll get into a little bit more of my career and then relate that over to why that qualifies as, you know, select board experience. My career started when I was at WPI. I first spent 2 months in Switzerland working at a company that does snow and avalanche research. Following year, I worked at NASA for 2 months working on linear encoders, which enable, you know, space vision telescopes, that type of equipment. After that, I've worked at companies like Raytheon, American Power Conversion, A123 Systems, which changed ownership a couple of times, and eventually became NEC Global, which is essentially the equivalent of GE of Japan. I'm currently the Vice President of Business Development for a company called OzTech in New Hampshire. We design and manufacture power supplies that support and enable renewable resources on the grid. And basically, I describe my experience as living in dog years, because working at a startup is no picnic. We worked very hard, and we did a lot of great things, and the company did very well and grew very quickly, almost too quickly. The company was then acquired by NEC, and, you know, many changes along the way. Over that period of time, I had a unique experience because I was able to work in a number of different capacities. I started out as an electrical engineer, then moved up to manage the sustaining engineering team, which did not previously exist. So that was a team that I started, put the process in place, hired the people, then I moved on to start the smart grid integration team, where we manage multi-million dollar grid scale batteries to support the wind and solar type applications. And then from there, I circled all the way back to manage the electrical engineering team where I started. And that gives you a perspective that not many people are able to get, so I feel very fortunate in that. From that experience, you know, I probably hired 30 people. And this year is critical for Berlin because we are hiring the town administrator. And until you hire a number of people, it's very difficult to know what to look for until you've actually made a couple mistakes and you learn from it and you move on. I've done that, and that's happened. So another key point here in my professional career is that I've come to realize the importance of culture. And culture is one of those things that is so powerful. It is more powerful than any one individual. I've seen positive cultures, I've seen negative cultures, and I've seen how the employees respond in those environments, and it is night and day. And especially for a town that is primarily run by volunteer organizations, we really depend on these folks, you know, to be interested in what they do. And the culture is of utmost importance. So to tie that back to, you know, leadership and hiring a town administrator, that's really what is most important. That's the focus. That's why I'm running. And in closing, running a town is very similar to running an organization. It's understanding people, it's looking at process, and it's making decisions. It's making good decisions that are in the best interest of everyone. And the only way to do that is through communication, transparency, and leadership. Thank you.
Tom, I might have missed it, but when did you say you moved to town, Greg?
I'll hang on to the mic.
Yeah,
7 years ago.
My first question is for Greg. This question is in reference to the warrant article on the upcoming town election in reference to the town of Berlin having a strong chief, fire chief, versus a weak chief, fire chief. And I have just a couple of questions about this. What is your view on the strong chief, weak chief question?
After seeing that on the warrant, I looked up the laws and actually spoke with members on the fire department and did some research. My position is I'm in favor of a strong chief. The reason for that is because the fire department is in situations where the chain of command is extremely important. And a strong chief has to have the ability to build his team the way it needs to be built in order for that team to be not only successful, but safe. And if they're not allowed to do that, lives are at stake. And that's really important.
If you had been a selectman at this time in Berlin, how do you feel? Would you have voted to have this question on the warrant at the same time we are in search of a new permanent chief? Do you think the timing of that is, what do you think of the timing of that?
The timing is interesting because the only time that a chief can be redefined as strong or weak is when there is no chief. And so having an interim chief opens that window. And so, in my view, you know, if you look at the job application for the chief that we're trying to hire, it doesn't mention weak chief. It's a little, you know, in my view, misleading. And so, you know, to answer your question directly, I would not have recommended to do it at this time.
Are you aware that in the past we had a weak chief, and then once we went to a strong chief, we had lots of problems with the strong chief doing whatever he wanted, hiring whoever he wanted, buying whatever he wanted, spending all kinds of money. We've got two malls and we've got apartments. In my mind, the police and fire have outgrown what we already need 5 years from now. So giving that power to a strong chief to hire and build a full-time department, I think, is a bad decision.
So the question was, the feeling is the town already has overbuilt its fire department. And given that the view is that the strong chief run amok, for lack of a better description, is that accurate?
Yeah.
And the question is then, given that, do I still maintain my position, or am I aware of that?
If you maintain your position, you can allow somebody else, even though with all good intentions you hire somebody else, and what happens when they run amok?
Sure. So the select board has full responsibility for, and the ability by MassMGL to manage the strong chief. And I equate that to a manager, or, you know, that's higher up in an organization, managing other managers.
And what is that time frame in which they can manage? Because right now, because
I'm not sure I understand.
You just quoted some mass law. So with that mass law.
Yeah.
And you can manage the strong chief.
Yep.
What are, can you name your powers?
As a member of the select board?
Yeah, can you name your powers?
Sure, you can call that chief in and meet with him and, you know, basically have a session to execute it, in short, disciplinary actions.
Greg, it seems to be in your answer that there's a distinction without a difference between a strong and a weak chief. If it can be done with a strong chief, it can be done with a weak chief. There's a distinction without a difference. And I don't think you believe that.
No, the difference is that in a weak chief scenario, the weak chief has to and must seek approval for their actions.
Just hiring.
In hiring.
Their command remains constant. I just wanted to understand if you believe that there appears to be in your answer no difference between strong and weak, and I can't imagine that's what you believe.
There's a limited difference, but I think it's a very significant one.
Okay, so my next question is for Chris. This question is in reference to the potential land swap at 58 South Street. And for people who don't know what that is, that's the land adjacent to Berlin Memorial School. Rhodes Construction is going to build 12 houses on six acres of land. The land swap was for that 6 acres in exchange for an amount of land on River Road that CASA Construction has under agreement. Total amount of land is 50 acres. They want to build on a 29-acre parcel. That's also a question at town meeting. My question related to the 58 South Street project is, for Chris, is it true that Tom Andrew, who was a previous town of Berlin selectman, an attorney, offered to help negotiate this land swap deal pro bono? Is that true?
He did offer to help. However, the board chose to move forward the way we did.
I guess I'd like to understand why somebody who knows the town so well and offered to do this pro bono and who's an attorney was turned down.
To make a long story short is that when you're on a board, it has to be a decision of the board, and the board chose not to have Thomas help at the time. I have always felt free that I could go and talk to him at any time. I don't know if that's okay. Answers your question.
Well, sort of. I just feel like he had extensive experience and that it would have been a benefit to us. Is it also true that the town incurred legal expenses associated with this land swap negotiation? Did we use our town law firm to negotiate?
No.
Okay.
No, we did not.
So we did not incur any legal expenses?
No, we did not.
Were you the prime negotiator?
I had Paul McKelp from the Board of Health attended all the meetings with me, and we did it together.
And what was the outcome?
Okay. The outcome is that right now that particular land swap is not on the table.
Okay. Can you tell me why it failed? Why the negotiation failed?
I can tell you why.
The negotiation didn't fail. I think it's at a point where it wasn't going to work for at least one of the two parties.
Okay.
It's a negotiation between the two parties, the town and the owner.
I'm just interested why Tom Andrew wasn't involved in the negotiation.
Because he was no longer a town official.
Okay, but he offered to do it pro bono.
Nobody wanted him.
I'm sorry. Okay. I'm sorry. I didn't hear you.
Yeah. He said nobody wanted him.
Okay. Nobody wanted him.
I'm just repeating.
Okay. I don't remember being asked.
This is about the candidate.
Okay. Let's get back to
so the topic. So Chris said that we didn't pay for it. We didn't pay legal fees for that negotiation at all. Do you want to go back and check that before you say that?
Well, the only thing I can think of that we may have incurred. No, I don't think we did actually. We did have our attorney come to an executive session. No, it wasn't an executive session. It was a public meeting. And that was because she happened to be there for the ZBA on the same evening. So I don't believe we incurred any cost.
$20,000 charge for that.
Excuse me?
I understand it may be a $20,000 charge for that negotiation.
No.
No.
Well, actually, I'd like to hear Chris's position on the strong chief, weak chief.
Perfect.
Given that the Mass MGL that Greg referenced has very structured rules on how much the select board gets to oversee the strong chief, gets to oversee and approve the budget, gets to oversee and approve the procedures that the strong chief puts in place. So my feeling is whatever happened in the past may have been more related to bad management than the individual person or their actions. So I'd like to understand your position going forward.
So my understanding of the Mass MGL laws that Greg had referenced about the strong chief versus the weak chief and what it allows and doesn't allow the select board to be able to do, it does allow the select board to be able to approve the budget that is set for the fire department, and it also allows for them to review on a whatever basis they want to the expenditures of that budget so that they can review what's going on. They also get to review and understand the procedures that are put in place for the fire department. And they have every right in the contract to make sure that those procedures meet with best practices of the NFPA and the state fire department. So there's a lot of things that are structured around a strong chief and controlling it, which the complaints that I've heard would be well addressed if they were just paying more attention. But the other side of the coin, in my opinion, is that the strong chief versus the weak chief, he gets to run his department without political influence, which is really necessary when you're running an organization that is about to save your kid up at the top of the house.
Which of the two is that?
Well, you have a strong chief, you have a weak chief. When he puts his procedures in place, if you have the local politician deciding what procedures he should put in place, they fire experts, if he hires people. But if you don't like the people that are on the fire department, he wants to get rid of them, that also has to be a hearing situation. So he just can't willy-nilly fire people that he wants to fire, or she wants to fire. I shouldn't be sort of jealous. So there's controls that are in place. What I feel, quite frankly, is that we have a town select board that wants to be deeply involved in the decision making of departments, and that really scares me. Not just about the weak chief, fire chief. It's what the hell is going to happen with the town administrator.
Well, I would disagree that I don't think this board wants to have to make decisions for the fire chief. I think the most important thing is that we have find someone that we can work with that's going to have good communication between the board and the fire department. And that particularly wasn't happening towards the end of our previous fire chief's tenure. There were things that we found out that, it was too late at that point.
It's a management issue.
And yes, it is a management issue. However, I'm going to restate that it's got to be a give and take, and that's what we'll be looking for in a new fire chief. And as far as strong versus weak, do you want to know my opinion on that too?
Yes.
Okay. I know that we've talked about how politics gets involved when it's a weak chief. There was an awful lot of politics involved with a strong chief too. I think, like I said before, it's going to be the person you hire, and that's what we're going to have to try to be very careful to hire. I don't think it's going to make a difference to me, personally, weak or strong. I think the reason it's on the warrant is because we wanted to hear from you guys.
Now, with the previous chief stuff, Everybody's lashing out at Chris here, but there were two other board members at the time when he was hired, and there were two other board members that renewed it at the same time. So she inherited a problem that she had no control of because she was outvoted by the two other board members.
Exactly. A question from Craig. Just curious, how many, if any, of the town board meetings and things like that have you attended? Have you been to any zoning meetings? Have you been to any selectman meetings? You know, just to get your sense of what's going on and how the government operates and how you might step into that role.
Sure. I currently serve on the Recreation Committee as well as the Energy Committee. I think I may have overlooked that in my intro. But yes, I currently serve on two boards in town. So I'm involved with the accountant, I'm involved with the board, I'm involved with, you know, many aspects of the town and how it operates today.
Have you attended any selectman meetings?
Yes.
And what are your thoughts about the selectman meetings?
Let's see, they're interesting.
So this question's for you, Greg. Hi, Greg.
Hi.
As you know, we know each other from the interaction between the Recreation Committee and the Economic Development Committee. You presented the Wellness Trail to the Economic Development Committee twice. We offered some input, questions, guidance, and you had some questions as well. I also tried to recruit you to join the Economic Development Committee because I thought highly of you. At that time, you said you didn't have time to join the Economic Development Committee because of your schedule and your time and reasons of your own. Things have changed, you've said, and now you've got the time to go from a little, small entity Economic Development Committee to a huge responsibility in selectmen, the role of a selectman. It's a little hard to understand for me if you know that we've spoken about that.
Sure.
As many of us know, last year at town meeting, you and the Recreation Committee presented a wellness trail proposal that was estimated to cost, as you know, $74,000. We voted to support the measure and it passed. Unfortunately, the bids came in at more than triple what you proposed, some $218,000 and $292,000. I feel you're a really smart and capable guy, and I really do. I serve on the same committee as Bud, who you work for and respect you highly. I respect Bud's input as well. But you feel it's not a fail. I think that's your terminology. You can explain what you mean to those that don't understand that, as you say. But what went wrong? Think about it. We're going to possibly elect you to become a select person, selectman, and we need to depend on skilled estimating, budgeting, planning, if you're elected. And the second part of the question I'll ask is, and try to, if you don't mind, answer them both. Tens of thousands of dollars are floating around in our town coffers that are unused. And the wellness trail is, of course, not built. Mm. What are your plans, at least, to return the money, if at all, or build the trail, given the big delta? So those are two questions. How did you go so wrong? And how do you feel about what's your plan for the money in the trail?
All right, so I will try and answer as many of those questions, and if I miss one, please let me know. I think I heard at least three.
Can you hold the mic up just a bit?
Sure, yep.
Repeat the questions.
So that...
If you can, or I can try.
Yeah, let me try and summarize what I heard. Peter's view is the wellness trail is a fail. I'm going to explain why I disagree. Peter would like to know how the bid was so different, how our estimate was so different from the bid. That's two. Was there a third?
The money.
We'll start there. So my definition of a fail would have been spending, you know, throwing caution to the wind and just spending to get it done. That's my definition of a fail. So what we did, and it has in part to do with the process of bidding within a town. When you're a municipality, as I'm sure you know, you have to follow the public bid process. So it's a little bit of a catch-22. You can't legally go out and get a bid until you have the money. You can't get the money until it passes a town meeting and is estimated, right? And so...
But you can get an estimate. You can get an estimate.
No, you can't.
An estimate, not a bid.
It's a fine line, and we were told by the board we were not to communicate with any contractors.
So then how possibly could you ever go and make a proposal if you don't have a...
Right, that's... we're agreeing right now.
We don't do asphalt.
Correct. So what we did is we had a fantastic volunteer in town who has done construction management and was also involved in the playground estimation. And the materials were estimated. And I think there was two factors at play there in the cost. We put the, because of the cycle of the approval, the funding, the bid process, it went out to bid after Labor Day. Every paving company out there is scrambling to finish their jobs before winter. And they're backed up, they have a backlog, they're booked through the rest of the year. And we put the bid out and we said, you know, we're gonna put it out mid-September, and by the way, you have to be done and cleaned up by, I think it was a date in November or December. And so, in hindsight, that was the busy season. That's when you put a job out to bid where you're gonna get the highest prices back. So the Recreation Committee is gonna rebid that very shortly in the spring as the concrete companies, I'm sorry, the paving companies are now coming back out to do work. So that's one. Two is, if we get those responses back, they're also higher than expected, then we're gonna go back to town meeting and say, this is what we learned. So no money has been spent. And I think a fail would be, you know, any number of things but what happened. A fail would be the committee changing the scope of the project to meet the budget without communicating it. A fail would have been spending too much to get it done. A fail would have been, you know, any number of things. But right now, it's a volunteer committee. Everybody's got kids in sports. We're doing what we can. We've relied on someone who's been in the industry for 30 years, maybe more. And we're gonna go from there. So we're gonna keep at it until we're successful.
So the second part was, what are you gonna do with the current money that's not sunsetting? There's no sunset clause for, does everyone understand what sunset clause is?
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, what are you doing with the money in between last fall and the future for the project? So it would strike me as logical to at least share with the town prior to my asking the question that answer.
Sure. The answer to that question depends on the bids that we get back in the spring. If the bids we get back in the spring are still consistent with what we got in the fall, then we're looking at a scope change if we want to keep the cost down. Or to keep the scope the same, we're looking at spending more money. And I would expect that to go back to town meeting for that decision.
Yeah, this question is for Chris.
Okay.
We had an incident recently that the town building inspector was forced onto unpaid medical leave while he was undergoing treatment for a possibly cancerous tumor. And I wanted to understand why would you do such a thing?
Well, first of all, I'm not quite sure where you have gotten this information, because this is personnel information and executive session information.
I got it from the footage of the select board in March 9th, I think it was, in early March.
Okay.
Which was reported and posted online.
Okay. Well, I have done my best to try not to share personnel information and executive session information. Something you said made me think that.
Okay.
But we went with our attorney's advice on this. That is basically...
You went with your attorney's advice
that this would trigger FMLA.
This is part of what I'm trying to understand, is that the decision seems to be, if, as I understood it, a decision that you made outside the context of the select board and then brought back. No, you're saying no, but the there was a discussion at the select board about how this was a decision that you had made without the feedback from the rest of the board, and I'm trying to put that into context.
This was a decision that was written in from our attorney. This was the best scenario for this employee, and I don't really feel comfortable saying much more than that.
I have permission from the building inspector and his wife to discuss this here, and the building inspector's wife attempted to discuss it at the meeting, but you refused to allow her to speak because you said it was administrative, and I find that very, very odd, that you, if you're concerned about that degree of confidentiality, that you wouldn't allow her to speak on his behalf.
Exactly, and that's why I did stop her from speaking at that meeting, and a board member. Things like that are confidential, they're personal, and they're personnel.
You find it inappropriate to public?
I'm sorry?
And it's kind of inappropriate we have this conversation in public.
It is, and that's why I'm really uncomfortable.
Me too.
Sharing any more information.
Just quick, can you help explain to the people here and watching this your exact role in denying or approving workman's comp? What is the role of the selectmen to do that?
The selectmen have no role in that. The information is given to workman's comp internally, and that's it. They make the call on positive or negative as far as workman's comp.
This question is for Greg. Hi, Greg. I'm Brennan Ewing. So, this is sort of a general, I'm sure you have executive experience.
Sorry.
You know, in a business setting, this is a town where we try not to gossip about each other, but pretty much everyone doesn't. Sometimes we like people and sometimes we don't. So having differences of opinion has sometimes led people to take legal action against their neighbors or worse. What steps do you plan to take to ensure you remain neutral and non-biased as a town official?
So, by definition, I am going to stay neutral as an elected official.
Yes.
Is there something else you're referring to?
No, that's awesome. Thank you.
I just would like, I'm here tonight to find out why you think you're going to be the best selectman possible. And I'm hearing all of this, for lack of a better word, tit for tat, which I'm not learning anything about either one of you. So my question is, what is it that you think you can offer our town over the next 3 years?
I believe, hopefully my record speaks volumes as far as the experience I have. I have helped to choose administrators at the school. We've chosen several employees through the town. I've negotiated teacher contracts. Just the experience that I carry, I'm hoping that you will understand how helpful that is in this role. Does that help answer your question, Janet?
Well, what is it that you think are your best skills moving forward that will help us?
I pride myself in being a good listener and trying to make decisions without jumping into something too quickly. I need a chance to think things over sometimes, and that's why a lot of times you take things under advisement, so you have a chance to think about things before you jump in and give an answer right off the bat. When someone shows up at a meeting and wants an answer like that, you take it under advisement, so you have a chance to reflect on it. And I do a lot of that kind of thinking, trying to make sure that I'm making the right decision. And I encourage people all the time, please call me if you have a concern or a question, because if you have a question or a concern and makes me think about the way to solve a problem, That's very helpful to me because I want to hear the other side if I'm not seeing it right off the bat.
So what's important to me, I touched on it a little bit in the beginning of the session, is being successful in transitioning this town into a town administrator situation. Hiring a town administrator does not begin with a resume and end with "you're hired." That's not how a successful hire takes place. Successful hiring has to do with fit, has to do with culture, has to do with coaching. And that's something I've done quite a bit of. And the reason that I will make a great select person is because I've had a tremendous amount of experience in those types of scenarios. I'm able to have a discussion about anything with anyone, so if there's any follow-up questions that you'd like to ask, you know, after the meeting, please do, and please be blunt. I won't be offended. I think somebody with that type of mentality is what we need on the board, somebody who's not going to take sides, somebody who's going to stay neutral, somebody who's going to do the right thing for the town, keep your eye on the prize, and let's solve a problem. My career is in solving problems. You know, it started out solving technical problems, then it transitioned to solving organizational problems, then it transitioned to solving business problems, finance problems, and it's all about problem solving. So with the right approach, the right level of communication and transparency and leadership, I think that's why I will make a great select person.
Just on your LinkedIn, you have under the volunteer, I just want to understand the Energy Committee, you listed yourself as vice president. We don't have vice presidents, and we have chairs, we have clerks, we have members.
So vice chair, is that what
you mean? It says vice president.
Okay, I'll fix it.
Okay. it was really confusing because that's kind of like escalating your role.
I apologize for that, so I will fix that tonight.
But why did you list it?
Well, when we were on the Energy Committee, Tim Wysocki became
chair,
and I believe I was nominated vice chair.
Correct. But LinkedIn states vice president.
Really?
Yeah, it's right.
No, I'm not questioning that it does. I'm actually surprised at this type of a question.
It also references the town of Berlin and the state of Maryland.
That is something I'm sure LinkedIn is associating with. I'll look into that. Thank you for bringing that to my attention.
It may not allow you to do vice chair.
It's an unanswered question from Peter's question, and it was about time frame. About your time frame wasn't available before, but now it's available now.
Oh, yes. Thank you.
I wasn't finished. I've never seen another selectman spend more time. I'm down in the town offices all the time. And it's not just a one night a day gig. There's all kinds of extra hours that need to be put in. Your opponent is there all the time working on behalf of the town. And so do you work from home? Do you work on a computer? Are you able to fulfill all those obligations all of a sudden?
Yes, there's a two-part answer to that question. And the first part, I'll answer Peter's first question about, you didn't have time before, why do you have time now? So Peter invited me to join the Economic Development Committee. And I said, I'm already on two committees. I have this full-time job. I got a lot going on at home. I just can't do it. So the situation has changed. I've since changed jobs from a 9-to-5 engineering-centric role to more of a business development and sales role. So that means my schedule is wide open. I make my own schedule.
Nobody makes their own schedule.
Do you make your schedule?
I work for everybody.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So the second part of your question, so that's what's changed. So the town administrator is going to relieve a tremendous amount tremendous burden from the select board once they are up and running. That's the second part. That's the second facet to the question. So there is an initial investment in that person, in that role, getting them to be successful. And once they get rolling, I do expect, as does, you know, many other people, that the select board obligation will be greatly reduced.
What's the biggest issue facing Berlin in your mind?
Well, in my opinion, I would say a successful transition to having a town administrator. You know, that's why I'm running. I think that's a big issue. There's a lot of other issues out there to tackle. That's right up there. That would be the single biggest one for me. Thank you.
Well, first we, with, as far as the town administrator is concerned, first we have to get through town meeting and approve the budget for the town administrator. Hopefully that will happen. As I've been getting to know people even more over the last month or two, I'm hearing things that are important to them. And two of them are budget and taxes, and trying to keep the budget in line so that their taxes don't go up as high. Although I do have to remind you all that, you know, you just got your tax bill, and just remember that when you go to town meeting and vote yes for everything. So that's just a reminder. The other thing I heard from a lot of people was rural. They like that Berlin's rural and trying to keep it that way. And I met a couple of young couples who just moved into Berlin, and that's why they moved here. So that's an important thing for me, those two things, keeping the budget on, keeping it on task, you know, getting things accomplished with, you know, not an exorbitant amount of money, and rural.
I've recently been watching TV, trying to watch all the meetings, and I've seen three meetings where a committee member has absolutely disrespected members of our community, either employees or members of other committees. I understand that this is a committee that's overseen by another person and not the Board of Selectmen, but I want to know what each of you feel it's important, and it's time for the Board of Selectmen to step in and intervene in this. It's not reflecting well on our town.
Sure, so if I understand the question correctly, you're saying you've seen a number of meetings where there has been disrespect or other forms of...
Disrespect.
Disrespect, okay.
Disrespect.
Okay, yeah, completely unacceptable. Mutual respect is part of the culture that I was describing earlier, and that's, you know, being disrespectful is, you know, will erode a culture faster than anything else that I've seen.
So you're saying the Board of Selectmen will step in, or should step in immediately if you're part of it?
There's a succession of steps, corrective actions, that can be taken in those types of scenarios.
One of the most important things to me is being respectful. Being respectful of all of you, and having you respect me in return. And I don't like to tolerate anybody who's disrespectful. I'm not quite sure if it's a scenario that I'm aware of. It didn't ring a bell, but bullying and being disrespectful is not tolerated, as far as I'm concerned. I don't know if that's too general for you, or does that help?
No, it's probably something that should be addressed in a smaller group, but I do think that a lot of us have witnessed this on YouTube and at different meetings. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, we have had little conversations about it.
Well, one of the most important things on being the Board of Selectmen is you need to be able to feel as though you can share your opinion. And I tend to turn to my left and ask an opinion, then to the right, and then I usually give my own. Or I could ask myself, or could share my opinion first and then turn to the other two. But that's exactly, if you feel like you can't even share an opinion, then that's an issue. And I would want to be let me know so we could do something about it.
Question for Greg. You've been in town 6 years, do I understand that correctly?
Seven, yeah.
Seven, okay.
Yeah.
I hear a lot of people in the weeds here, and this is a very important summer, important year for us, because we will be hiring a town administrator. I'd like to hear from you, because you made a reference earlier about understanding the culture and all that, how you can make 7 years equal 10 to 15 or 20, whatever Chris has. Because understanding the fabric of Berlin doesn't happen overnight. I'm still finding out people are related to each other that I had no idea. And you're gonna walk into that same trap.
Yeah.
And there's no magic pill for that.
Sure. I think the best answer I could provide for that question is that, it's, you know, there are consistent topics that have come up earlier. It's, you know, it's respect, it's leadership, it's communication, it's transparency. You know, your question was aimed at, you know, how does my 7 years of living here qualify me to be on the board? And my answer to that would be my 15 plus years in my professional experience in a number of different roles is what qualifies me to be on the select board.
I guess my question wasn't clear enough then, because that really isn't my question. We're talking about hiring somebody who's going to be involved with all the departments, with people, and some select board is going to be there to work with this person, male or female, doesn't matter. And there has to be a really good roots understanding of Berlin. I mean, you can hire engineers, you can do this, you can do that. It's a whole different world, what we're talking about, what we're going to be entering into this year. And experience in the town is just huge in my mind.
In the end, it just comes down to working with people. If you can have a conversation, if you can sit across the table and work with someone, understand their side, seek to understand, make sure they're heard, and take into consideration, you know, the points and the feedback that you get from the folks that you work with.
Greg, could you just share with the public what you shared with me on the genesis of you becoming interested in running for selectman? How did that happen? Going from two committees that you're on to having an interest in such an important role?
Sure. It was mentioned to me that, hey, you know, maybe you should think about running for selectman. And I thought about it and I said, you know what? That's a great idea. And I started thinking about it and looking into it. And I felt that this was, you know, the right year. And it was a great opportunity. Something that's, you know, it's a great experience.